I have two issues. One, as a resolution I'd like to put off to next month. The second is, I want to discuss the meeting, and it was just brought to fore by one of your constituents complaining that you guys were not there at the meeting to voice a position in the negative when you guys chose to boycott our special call meeting on the 18th of January. What we have is a situation where we need to figure out how to couch this in the future. If commissioners decide not to come to a meeting, how does it count? I was all under the impression at that time that all votes counted in the affirmative unless otherwise recognized and forgiven and allowed to not be there. That was not the case. However, Billy has made some inquiries, and I think he's pretty well fixed on the fact that you are in the, you're not in the affirmative, you're just not here. Correct. In that case. Billy, would you state what you have found to that effect?
Well, first of all, you need to look. I believe it's in your minute book right there, just before you. Mm-hmm. Let's look over at page 115. First, let's look at the special meetings. And that's what occurred. It puts in the chair or a majority of the member of the board may at any time call a special meeting. That's page 115. It's section rule 6, subsection B. And it says, we call a special meeting by signing a notice stating the time and place of the meeting and the subjects to be considered. I'm assuming that was done. And I believe it was done by a majority of the members of the Board of Commissioners, which would be 4 out of 7. So there could be a duly called special meeting.
Got it.
Said the person who called the meeting shall cause the notice to be posted and so on. That's just your procedure. And the notice shall be delivered to individual person, news media, who have requested notice provided. And then only those items of business specified in notice may be transacted at special meeting unless all members are present or those who are not present have signed a written waiver. So you only have four commissioners, majority at that special call meeting. 3 commissioners were not present at that meeting. So number one, that vote can't. Then you jump over to these. Our rules are patterned after the general statutes of North Carolina relating to county government. And you go over to page 120, and you'll see over there, that's under rule 20. And it is the duty of each member to vote unless excused by a majority vote. A person could be excused if he has a conflict. But that a member who is present at the meeting who fails to vote, not having been excused, shall be recorded as voting in the affirmative. And the 3 commissioners were not there, were not present at that meeting. So obviously you can't count their absence as being an affirmative vote. They just simply were not at a special meeting. And then the other that Mr. Commissioner Daffney raised an issue about is Rule 24. And if you look at that, it's on page 121 in your minutes, and it states a majority of the board members shall constitute a quorum, and that's what you had. And if a member is withdrawn from a meeting without being excused, it says that he or she shall be counted as present for the purpose of, just maintain your quorum. And it says, if you didn't have a quorum, then it says also that the board may compel the absence of an absent member by ordering the sheriff to take the member into custody. Pretty tough rule, but it is in your rules of procedure. Of course, that did not occur at that special call meeting, so there was no way that you could say that the there's nothing in the statute that states that a sitting county commissioner has to attend every meeting. They can't be absent. They don't count. They're simply absent. And if they're present, they do help constitute your quorum. So I don't believe, Mr. Jeffries, you can call those that were not present as being an affirmative vote. I think it's pretty clear you can't. And but the only thing you could do, if you want to produce a vote, I guess you could say you could request a sheriff. I think one we did run into that instance one time some number of years ago, if I remember correctly.
1995.
Yeah, I think the sheriff didn't actually go out and see him. They called, and that commissioner did show up.
Yeah, I remember that.
So that's basically as you get questions. I'll be trying to answer as best I can. But and I've researched enough that I'm pretty well satisfied that you can't count affirmative vote for those absent members.
Now, you'll understand, it's not my 17 years of being a commissioner. It's the first time we've ever had it, just a mass exodus of a group of commissioners. And I didn't know how it was supposed to be handled. I thought maybe they would count in the affirmative if they had not been forgiven.
I understand where you're coming from, but it just it doesn't.
We have it the same way we do tardiness.
Well, no, if you don't show, you don't show. There's a big difference between being a few minutes late. I mean, you weren't here and you weren't going to be here. There is your one of your constituents in the back when she gave her redress to the commissioners in her public comments. She did mention that she would like you guys to write an independent report and state why you would have been in the negative, if in fact you would have been in the negative.
I would have anyway.
But you see, that is why I think it's paramount that you show up, because you do represent these people.
Okay.
And I mean, I don't mean to preach to you, but you do represent
Let me suggest this to you. If it means that much to you, why don't you make your motion again? Commissioner Destrick can second, and we'll vote, and we'll make it all official. How about that?
I don't think so.
It's already done.
Right. I don't think so.
So it's a moot point then, correct?
No, it's not a moot point. It's not a moot point.
The resolution is moot, but the attendance factor is not moot. We have an understanding as of tonight. However, you may see more of these coming up, and I hope that you will come to the next one.
Well, Stan, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Stan, I hope you bring all you get ready. That's your right. But I ain't following you nowhere. Only place I'm going to follow you is somewhere where you won't come back.
No, you don't have to follow me anywhere to be at these meetings. You are elected to be here. It's not a question of following me or not following me.
Okay.
We're elected to do county business.
Yeah. Right. This is county business.
I would just like to point out that the oath that you take when you're sworn in is for the Constitution of the United States. It's not for Beaufort County. So that gives you a lot of latitude. But I did consider asking the sheriff to go pick up the three commissioners.
No, I've done that.
There was a good reasons for not doing this. I didn't believe that the Democrat sheriff would cooperate with us to pick up three Democrat commissioners who were not coming to a meeting, and that would have stymied the purpose of what we were here for. So we were very successful in doing for the people what needed to be done, and contrary to what the Democrats may believe, we have had an awful lot of comments about this, and there are several counties in North Carolina that are going to enact the same resolution tonight. So, and several states, there are counties that are.
You have state governments enacting this.
I think, Mr. Richardson, I think if the sheriff, he's on the same constitution the rest of us. You can call him and tell him to come get us. He don't care whether you're Democrats or Republicans. He'd come guide us. But I would told him, just like I told you, I ain't coming. He'd have had to come got me.
Well, I mean, if that's what it takes, that's what it takes. It'll be a whole lot of fun to go through one of those.
That's what it would have took.
I just have one comment, and I'll end it here. You got to understand, for 17 years, both Commissioner Richardson and I have been on this Board of Commissioners, and we've been in the minority a lot, and a lot of things have happened we have not voted for. Now, what if we did not come because there was a
blessing?
But still, I was elected to show up. I did come, and I voted, and I expressed why I voted the way I did. I think it is incumbent upon you commissioners to do the same.
Are we protected under the Constitution to tell you?
Absolutely.
We ain't got to tell you nothing.
No. You don't represent me, but you do represent your constituents.
Good.
Your constituents got left out.
Well, let me say this. Of all the constituents that I have, I've had a single one call me and complain about not attending. As a matter of fact, the Buckhome who called me and said, I am so glad you did not go get involved in that foolishness.
Yeah, one man's foolishness is another man's constitution.
So that's what I'm saying. You know,
that's a good statement.
We have to keep it real. You know, that some people feel good about what you've done and others don't.
and I'm not mad about it.
According to recent public polling in the state of North Carolina, 56% of the people are in favor of doing away with or banning assault weapons, and 81% of the people, this is public policy polling organization, 81% of the people are in favor of stricter gun control laws. So you may be in Beaufort County with your constituents, you may be in the majority, but in the state of North Carolina, you're not in the majority. In the last decade, in the state of North Carolina, the crime rate has gone just like this, down. Death by weapons has gone up. 12,000 people have died on the streets of the state of North Carolina in the last decade by weapons. If you don't believe it, read yesterday's News and Observer. The public policy polling has done their research. Why is it that you can sit in North Carolina, and I'm not opposed to concealed carry permits, but why is it that in the state of North Carolina, we have reciprocity with other states on concealed carry permits? Concealed carry permits in other states have less regulation than North Carolina does on concealed carry permits. Anybody in some states can get a concealed carry permit. But more people have died in the last decade on the streets of our country from people shooting each other in the United States of America, 100 times more people than died in the war in Iraq. Folks, something's got to be done about Americans shooting each other. 16 incidents in the past several years of mass killings. What do you think the people at Sandy Hook would say about your resolution? The people in Newtown, Connecticut, the people at Columbine, the people in Aurora, Colorado, the people who were shot out of the bell tower at the University of Texas, what would they say about your resolution? I don't think they're here to say anything. They're dead.
The people that were killed. Okay. Do you want to go or do you want me to go?
Well, let me just say this. Using that kind of logic, cars, automobiles in the United States kill and maim hundreds of thousands of people every year. Using that kind of logic, then we should ban automobiles and seize them because it's killing people. The issue is not guns. The issue is the mentality of the people who are using the guns.
Furthermore, if I might answer.
Safer in Iraq than I am here.
If I may answer, you're quoting statistics. The special call meeting was not about statistics. It was really not even about gun control. It was about the Constitution of the United States of America, specifically the Second Amendment, specifically executive orders telling us exactly what we will and won't do. Now, Congress will be involved in any gun control, any real meaningful gun control. Our state legislature will be involved in any real meaningful gun control, if there is any. And what we did was send a message to state legislature and to our manager and to our sheriff that we don't plan to follow executive orders that come out of Washington, D.C. And because you guys didn't show up, it is a unanimous vote not to follow what comes out of Washington, D.C. as executive orders. So this was Democratic government ensuring that we will continue this republic, irrespective of people dying at the hands of crazy people.
But I can honestly say this to you, Commissioner Deatherage. The same sheriff you wanted to send after the three Democratic
committees. No, nobody said. I didn't
you
say that.
You rebel against the government, he'll be coming for you.
That's what we're afraid of.
Yeah.
We are afraid that this government is getting ready to start seizing people and putting them into camps.
You just said pretty much what we're afraid of.
That's part of the fear.
But see, but the thing you got to understand is, I'm not against people having guns. I got a gun. That's not the whole issue. What you're saying is, it's all right for citizens to have fully automatic weapons and just run free with them. I don't agree. The thing about it is, if they were strict, the average deer hunter, if you went back old school and had a 30-30 rifle or a 30-06 or even a 7mm, you could kill anything you wanted to kill. Why do you need to shoot at something 30 times? Your shooting's that bad.
It has nothing to do with hunting.
Well, there's no.
No, I'm
Second
I'm
Amendment
just saying,
has nothing to do with hunting.
The average person who gets a gun, they get them to go hunting.
That's true, but they don't understand the Second Amendment.
Not for killing people.
No, they have it for protection.
That's what the Second Amendment says. It doesn't talk about deer hunting. It talks about
it's all
militia.
Drink
it
alcohol
talks about
too,
killing
but people.
People
get drunk, don't they?
The second,
right.
We have the
but
Second that, Amendment that,
I mean,
to defend ourselves against people.
You're confusing.
I'm not confusing.
You're confusing yourself. You're faking yourself. You got somebody from the audience entering into the conversation.
No, just ignore her and keep going.
He
don't
ain't got
drag
that
her
kind of
this.
Sense. He ain't got that kind of sense.
All right, let's go on. What's your point?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You don't have sense enough to ignore.
What's your point? Let's go.
You guys could be a little bit more polite. I mean, we can hurl insults too, Ed. You need to calm down.
Why is it that liberals, when they get arguing about an issue, they completely
forget
about what the issue is and start attacking the person that's arguing with them or debating them? Why is that?
As far as attacking,
I don't understand that.
We know who the folk are who notoriously attack people.
No, we talk, discuss the issues. Just because the issue is counter to what you believe, you think the Second Amendment is about hunting. I say it's about tyranny.
I never said it was
restricting
about
tyranny from your nation. And that's why our forefathers brought the Second Amendment, wrote it the way they did.
They didn't
and
have
those type of
know
weapons
a terrorist if we
well, no, they
the
had
room.
Muskets in. They didn't say, we get the muskets in the military. The rest of you don't get that. You get bows and arrows. They didn't say that. What they meant is you get the same kind of weaponry that the military has. I mean, if you really wanted to discuss it thoroughly and go back to the intent, we would have RPGs just like the military had RPGs. We're not saying that. We're saying eventually if you have a tyrannical leader, which someday that could happen, it's happened in other countries, the first thing they do is they take the guns. That happens in every society.
Now don't come to my house to take my
Excuse gun. Me, I'm talking. That happens in every society. Where you have a dictator take over. It happened in Hitler's Germany. It happened in Stalin's Russia. And that's what happens. Now, what we're saying is, in America, our forefathers had the wisdom, the good sense, to put forth that we would be able to keep and bear arms, not to hunt, not to make sure we brought down the biggest, baddest deer, but to protect our families and to protect our nation and protect the document. The Second Amendment actually protects all other amendments. The amendment that we have, the First Amendment, to speak now as we're speaking. And it's very important that we don't lose sight of that. And I think we have. I think you guys have.
No, I think you have.
No, I don't think so. I've written extensively on it. I understand it. I showed up for the meeting. You're talking about hunting.
Mr. Chairman, let me have one more go and I'll be done.
Okay.
There are no laws in the United States. There is no right in the United States to have fully automatic weapons, as I understand it, without special permits issued from the ATF. That's machine guns and things like that. You just can't have them. So when you say automatic weapons, they aren't out there. Every weapon that has ever been invented in the history of mankind was the most terrifying weapon that has ever been invented. The crossbow, because it had the force to go through the armor, the chain mail that warriors wore, was supposed to be the weapon that ended all warfare because it was so terrible. The atomic bomb was supposed to be the weapon that ended all warfare. As long as man is on the face of this earth, he's going to be trying to take something away from somebody else. That is his nature. So arguing about the ferocity of these weapons is not a legitimate argument, because after these weapons, they're going to be even more terrifying weapons.
Well, I think all of us can agree on this one thing. If it were entirely just about the weapons, it would be something different. But it's about people who have no value system when it comes to another human being's life. That's the problem I have with all of it. When you can get your weapon and you can get three or four magazines or clips, whatever you want to call them, and just walk somewhere and begin to spray the crowd, and before law enforcement can come, you've killed hundreds of people. That's my concern with this whole thing. I don't have a problem with people having guns as long as people got enough sense to know what to shoot.
Call that a people problem.
I don't have a problem with that. I don't have a problem with people being researched, and you make sure that the crazy people don't get the guns. The fact is, you've got to know who's crazy and who's not, and there's lots of laws to keep you from knowing this kind of information. That's not right either.
The background checks are okay?
I don't have a problem with background checks. Just don't say, I can't have the weapons I want to have.
At gun shows and between individuals trading guns?
I don't have a problem with that. But when you say you can't...
The resolution said that.
What?
The resolution had that in it.
Well, you weren't here, were you?
I read it. It's in the paper.
Personally, I don't have a problem with it. I do have a problem with you taking away. Excuse me. I do have a problem with you saying what kind of guns we can have and what kind of guns we can't have.
Executive orders that are the problem.
That's what I've already discussed, executive orders. That was the number one. It's really. We talked about the Second Amendment. If you were here, you'd have known that. We talked about the Second Amendment, but it was about taking away the rights of government at the local level, the state level, and saying the federal level is going to usurp our authority to govern ourselves. That was what it was about. We talked about a constitution and convention. We went far beyond the Second Amendment. So personally, I don't have a problem with all the things that were in there. I can negotiate. I'm not above negotiating, but I will not negotiate my rights to have a local government and a state government where the vast majority of my laws are made, and that is what I will follow, not what comes out of Washington, D.C.
All right. Mr. Jarvis, please come in. I know you're out in the foyer. Come on in. Let's move on.
Who's shooting?